wish that P.K. Nair Sahab had received the recognition that he deserved in his lifetime. But that is one of those things which we have no control over. I do not think that there could be a greater service rendered than what Nair Sahab did to the recording, the preservation, the searching out of old films, the recording of history, the painstaking labor that he put. I used to wonder when we were students, hey, what does this man sit and note down all the time? Why doesn't he watch the damn movie? I didn't realize he was watching the movie and making notes, and copious notes about every little detail of every single movie. It's just impossible to imagine that there could be a man who gave his whole life to just loving movies, and that's the only way I can put it. I'm proud to be associated with this book, and I'm proud to be associated with Shivendra and the work he's doing, and with my good friend Mr. V.V. Chopra, who I bumped into after very long. I'm very happy to be here, and I'm proud to be reading passages from Nair Sahab's book.
See, the what Naseer said, all I can say that I don't think I would be standing here but for Mr. Nair. I think he didn't only, of course, preserve everything, and I, like Naseer said, I still remember that little torch in the corner. But he was probably the only teacher I had at the Film Institute. He was the best teacher because he taught us by showing us cinema and talking about it. And I'll never forget, you know, there was a print of Breathless and I wanted to study it, and he could not officially give it to me, Naseer. So you know how Nair Sahab seriously walked, and he just said, Kokji and Dalvi Bara project, print you keep here at night. And then he walked away, just telling them to keep the print. And then Dalvi said, Nair Sahab bole, tum raat ko le jao, steady karke aao. This was the kind of man he was. And that is why I'm here. And I would do anything for Mr. Nair. And I agree with him. If the, you know, powers that be are listening, he deserves to be whatever, Padma Bhushan. For me, he deserves to be Bharat Ratna, actually.
He deserves the highest honor.
He absolutely and totally. And I think it's time we acknowledge that, and you know, if I ever become a minister, which I never will, I will do it for
you. For us, it's been a very memorable time, because when Nair Sahab passed away, one of the best gifts I could get was all the material which he possessed, he left behind for us in the archive at the Film Heritage Foundation. And I think for us, it was a starting point that what could be done with that material we have. And no better tribute can be made than the book which has come out of all that material we've had to reach out to millions of fans. You know, one of the things Nair Sahab did was that he, even after he finished his tenure at the NFAI as a director, he refused to go back to his lovely home in Kerala, but stayed in a small little dingy flat right next to the NFAI. And the idea was that he wanted to propagate, he didn't want to be away from film critics, film scholars, film fans, anybody to do with cinema, because I don't think he knew anything but cinema. So this book is something which has been compiled together for the very first time of all his writings, which will reach to millions of people. And I think that's why Vinod came on board, that what he's been propagating. And he's the only man in the history of Indian cinema who talks about the object, he talks about being a film fan, film critique, language, projection, every form of cinema is someone which you will, and it's a passionate, you know, person talking about. So we are very proud to be associated. We are very honored that both Vinod and Mr. Naseeruddin Shah and Shyam Babu, who's here, have taken out time to be with us and support not only the cause of what Nair Sahab stood for, but also the foundation, which is very important in taking his legacy forward.
Yeah, and I'd like to jump in and say on behalf of both Vinod and myself and every other film lover that we appreciate very much what Shivi is doing. He is probably the only one continuing Nair Sahab's tradition.
Absolutely.
Vidhu Vinod Chopra, who has generously supported the publication of this book, for which we are very thankful to him. Naya Sahab was mentor to Vinod, and we could not have asked for a better partner than him to support us on this book. Shri Naseeruddin Shah, who I have known since my days in Dune School, and has always come through for us whenever I have called upon him. It is truly a privilege, sir, to have you read extracts from Nair Sahab's book. Thank you very much for coming. Unfortunately, our chief guest and our brand ambassador, Shri Amitabh Bachchan, has suddenly fallen ill and he's not been able to attend. But he sent me this note while I was traveling to the venue, and I'm going to read a small message from him. Shivendra, I've suddenly and quite unexpectedly developed a high fever. I regret profusely that I shall be unable to attend the event this evening. A shame, really, because I was looking forward to it. As a country, we have shied away from the luxury of documentation, leave alone its restoration and preservation, for films at least. What you and your foundation have initiated is almost a selfless but very important and necessary element worked upon by Mr. Nair. I send my best wishes to the launch of your book on him and do stand by my commitment to the very service of this noble cause. Your idea of constructing an archive, the design which I've been working closely with you, is appreciated and most laudable, and one that I can hope shall receive patronage not just from the film fraternity, but indeed from the city of Mumbai, the film capital of the nation. Amitabh Bachchan. Thank you. I'm very happy to see many members of the film industry. Your presence here is a great show of support to our foundation. Thank you. Welcome also to Naseeruddin's family. We are delighted to have you with us. Thank you for coming. And of course, I cannot forget all our friends, family, and some of whom have flown down specially from this event and who have been unstintingly in their support for whatever we do. When Naya Saab passed away last year, his daughter Bina got in touch with me and told me that he had left behind his books, catalogs, files, journals to be handed over to the Film Heritage Foundation. This foundation was created with his ideology at the very onset. While going through the material, we discovered a treasure. Naya Saab had been a prolific writer, and we felt that the compilation of his writings would make a unique book on cinema. His passion for cinema leaps off the pages, and he writes on subjects as diverse as the song in Indian cinema, to his top 10 list of lost films, to saving Phalke films from extinction. And it was our editor, Rajesh Devraj, who I want to thank, who's done a wonderful job of structuring the book and editing these essays written by Naya Saab over the years. I would also like to thank Bala Nair, who's not with us here anymore, who guarded one of Naya Saab's very diaries, which he took when he was studying as a student at the FTI. And those famous diaries for which we've used as a source in this book. I wish we could have published the book in Naya Saab's lifetime, but I'm sure he would have been proud, as we are, with the way it has turned out. Before we move ahead, I would like to take a few minutes to tell you about the Film Heritage Foundation and our activities and our future plans. We started the Film Heritage Foundation in 2014 in response to the fact that we have lost a colossal amount of our film heritage and continue to lose more of it every day. We are amongst the few countries that just has one film archive, and given the sheer volume of films we have produced and continue to make, it's impossible for a single institution to bear the responsibility of this alone. Our film heritage belongs to us, and we need to invest in its future. One of the biggest challenges was the common attitude that the films are a commercial business for the entertainment. And they're not part of our social structural module. With the arrival of the digital age, most people believe that celluloid is outdated as long as you have digital copies. This is not true, as celluloid is still the only archival medium that has proven longevity of more than 100 years, if, of course, kept in proper conditions. And you will always need to go back to the original format of a film as the best source of quality restoration, as well as for making digital copies. Our objectives were to create awareness about the urgent need to preserve both filmic and non-filmic material, to restore films, keeping in mind the original creator's vision, to train an indigenous resource of film archivists and restorers, to develop educational programs for children, to sensitize them to the unique language of cinema, and to build a world-class film archive and exhibition center. We have since then conducted two of the most important workshops. We conducted the first one in Bombay at the Films Division, and we had the support of Martin Scorsese's Film Foundation.
And it was a 7-day intensive workshop which included theory and practical classes. Some of the images, there's a video which we have from Scorsese, which talks about our initiative. Second workshop was conducted at the National Film Archive in Pune, because we realized that the National Film Archive, being a government body, has a huge amount of material, and we wanted to train the staff there with the best of techniques. And these are some of the images of the workshop. You can see how the photochemical training was happening, how to actually repair a negative or repair a film, which a lot of people are not aware of, that can you repair celluloid? Yes, you can. You can even replace the sprockets, because before you put scanning. And also, one of the key things was photographic restoration, which we don't have. And we conducted that at the NFAI, which is, and how to preserve it. That's very important. Can we go to the next slide? Yeah. These were the batches. But look at the impact. Over these 2 years, we have introduced over 100 individuals to the best practices of film preservation and restoration. We've witnessed a change in the attitude of the film industry, as they are now becoming more conscious of preserving their film legacies. There's a change in the government policy with the start of the National Film Heritage Mission. But in the meantime, we wanted to build our own archives. And we started with our non-filmic archive. These are our archives. We have a growing collection of non-filmic archives, including scripts, posters, lobby cards, song booklets, photographic, and other memorabilia. We have an expert conservators who train and oversee our staff. We have developed our own cataloging system. And we are the custodians of several important archives, which you can see the list. We hold the archives of P.K. Nair, Kedar Sharma, A.R. Kardar, J.B.H. Wadia, Saeed Akhtar Mirza, Pran Saab. Pran Saab donated all his material to us, so we have his entire archive, and Kundan Shah. So these are the non-filmic, which is, I think, a very key and integral part of preservation. FHF has a growing collection of films in our vaults. We have 35mm of some films of Mr. Benegal, Mandi. We have Mr. Bachchan, of course, was an ardent collector. It was a rule with him that everybody who did a film had to deposit one print, subtitle and non-subtitle, to him. So we have his entire collection, so we can do entire. He has A to Z, all his films, and he used to keep it in his house. And one day he just called me and he said, Shivendra, I want you to look after these films. So we have his entire collection. We have Govindji's collection. We have also the collections of Kumar Shahani, Vishal Bhardwaj, Kundan Shah, Onir, Chitra Palekar, and of course Sumitra ji and Sunil ji, both Sunil ji is here. We have only one of the only people in India who can repair film. No one in India can repair if your celluloid is damaged. And no better example is set when we got the first ever film of Mogacho Ando. There was a filmmaker, a friend of mine, Roy, who just walked into my office with a film reel saying that it's a reel of the first Konkani film. And you can see some of the images, how badly it was damaged. This is how the state was. And we had to actually repair these. It's a kind of a restoration which we have to intake. And we put them under dehydration and rehydration treatment to actually repair these films. And believe me, all this is happening of my own cost. There is nobody supporting me. I've been doing this just on my own cost. And I appeal today, when I'm showing you these, that this is what Naya Saab did for 25 years, that when the government didn't have the money, he went relentlessly, and he was an inspiration. And that is why this is linked to that. That if I'm inspired and if I feel that I must save these films, it is because I have the ideology of P.K. Nair, because he only understood that. That every time he would call me and he would say, what have you saved? I remember Vinod is sitting here. Vinod wanted to offer him, you know, Vinod, if you remember, Vinod said, can I do something for Mr. Nair? He's living in this one room. And Nair Saab said, can he restore these films? I said, that I don't know. I'll check with Vinod when I meet him. So we saved this film, and it was such a delight to the actress who was forgotten and living in Andheri, the first Konkani film actress. And when we showed her a little clip, I don't know whether we have a clip or we don't have a clip right now. Okay. But this is the image we were able to restore it to. And it was unbelievable that the people had never seen this film, and it was all lying in a terrible state. So we are able to restore this. We also conduct a unique program of workshop for children called Do You Speak Cinema that teaches them the evolution of cinema and its unique language. So in fact, I take them through, Iravati is here, who's my partner and colleague, and she's someone who's designed this entire workshop of the children, where we take them through different mediums of the evolution of cinema, including zoetropes and magic lanterns, and we create that and we make the children also make those things. So that's one of our key things. We've been conducting these workshops at schools, museums, and cultural institutions. We published our first book, which was in 2015, which is the first ever book on film preservation and restoration, essays by Scorsese and many other writers. Our future plan is of course, the big workshop at Chennai, because Kamal Hassan was very keen that we've conducted two workshops successfully in Pune and at the in Bombay. The third one should happen in Chennai with the Tamil industry. And we got two big partners with us. One, of course, is Martin Scorsese, who's always there with us to support us, and the second is the Academy. The Academy is supporting us on this workshop, so our third major workshop will be to look into the industry down there, where we'll be working at the studios there. But the vision which Mr. Bachchan was talking about is what you're going to see. This is what we are working on, building this archive. And this is the plan of our future plan, which we hope that we will be able to do it. Saving our cinema heritage requires passion, commitment, and funding. We require the support of the film industry, as well as the corporates and the public, to support this neglected cause and help us save India's legacy for posterity. So this, thank you.
That was the only place I could keep them for a long time. And when I told Nair once, I said, look, I've got to have somebody who keeps these films. Will you be taking them? He said, I have one of each one of your films. So I said, but then what am I going to do with the ones that I have? He said, you send it to me. So I sent it all to him, and then it's there in Pune with him, you know. When it came to film, nothing was too much. He would accept anything that you offered to him. And I think there are very few people like him. Of course, I can count them on my fingers, two fingers. Ari Langlois, PK Nair. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shyam Babu. Can I request Vinod to... No, servants speak later, but first you. Yeah. Nini. To speak a few lines.
Okay.
You want to read?
Okay.
So, sir, you read. I don't need to introduce.
All right. Since Vinod decides to save up his knockout punch for the end,
no.
I will... Okay, I'm going to read you a few passages from Naresh Saab's book. This is a chapter called Film Preservation in India, and it is a chapter I personally found extremely moving, in which Naresh Saab talks about the travails of trying to track down forgotten movies, trying to trace film producers whom no one has heard of, no one hears about anymore, and the job of restoring these movies. It's widely known that the first Indian story film, Raja Harishchandra, was made in 1913 by Dada Saheb Phalke. What is not widely known is that the film perished a few years after it was made. The only surviving print of the film caught fire while it was being transported in a bullock cart from one tent cinema to the other. The actual cause of the accident was not known, but it was reported that the nitrate print had already had a large number of screenings and was practically worn out, and that the accident may have happened while loading or unloading. In 1917, when Phalke found out that the original negatives had also vanished, he reshot the film, duplicating the original shot by shot, taking the opportunity to insert title cards, asserting his claim to be the father of the Indian film industry. Like Phalke's films, many of the most important films in our history have not survived. Many have either turned to powder or have been lost in fires through accidents or negligence. Many others were lost when silver was extracted from the nitrate films, or when cellulose film was stripped and used to prepare bangles, ladies' handbags, and other curios. To think that Alamaram must be being worn around some lady's bangle today. Cottage industries that thrived parasitically off the filmmaking scene. According to informed sources, nearly 70% of the titles produced before 1950 have either deteriorated beyond repair or may be considered permanently lost. There are many reasons why we are in such a situation today. Barring a few pioneering exceptions, most of the early films were made by businessmen whose primary concern was making profits. Their interest in a film lasted only as long as it earned them money. Thereafter, they did not care about the whereabouts of the negatives or positive prints. Even if they did care, few had the facilities or the technical know-how to take care of highly inflammable nitrate films. As a result, many film negatives were simply allowed to perish. Filmmakers and authorities alike were not conscious of the historical or cultural importance of cinema. Film is highly fragile material which needs special care and attention for a longer life. However, under the British colonial regime, there were no organizations entrusted with the responsibility of treating cinema as a cultural product and ensuring its preservation for posterity. In the national consciousness, cinema always had a low level of priority. The taboos attached to the profession ensured that few people considered wasting their time in preserving films. A lack of awareness and understanding thus led to the wanton destruction of the country's film heritage. One such film happened to be Alamara, the first Indian talkie, which is still not traceable. When we contacted him 2 years before his death, Ardeshir M. Irani, the maker of the film, and the man who brought sound to Indian cinema, told us that he had kept some reels of the film in his office room at Imperial Studio, now Jyoti Studio. But his son Shapurji took us aside and confided, "The old man still thinks the reels are lying around in his office, but I know for certain they have been disposed of as junk. I myself did it as they were creating a fire hazard." What a pity. The man had no idea that he had allowed one of the most important historical records of Indian cinema to be destroyed. As a footnote, I want to mention that when I was in Nasik recently, this is in 2012, for the shooting of Celluloid Man, I discovered that the Phalke House no longer existed. A commercial complex had come up in its place. Searching for the prints of other silent films made in India was an even more Herculean task. It was a great adventure to visit the remote corners of the country to hunt for films. They were quite literally scattered around, turning up in such odd places as cowsheds and godowns belonging to owners of grocery shops. A few reels of Indian silent films were also found in foreign locations. Somehow, we managed to locate about 10 of the 1,500 silent feature films made in this country between 1913 and 1932. Most of Phalke's family members and heirs we met in our search were happy to collaborate with us. Often they helped us collect films and supplied information we needed. Yet there were bitter encounters as well. Sometimes doors were shut in our faces and we were told to get lost. "Don't even utter the word film in this house." Our father lost all the family property in making films, and we have yet to recover from the loss. Then there was the time a grocery shop owner told us, "Yes, I have a wooden box containing some old films lying in my attic. By the way, how much can you pay?" We asked to look at the box, but he would not show it, despite repeated requests. "First tell me how much you are offering, then I'll show you." I told him I needed to have a look at the material to find out whether the reels were intact or had deteriorated and turned to powder. When he refused to relent, his son took me aside to a corner and confided, "It's difficult to argue with the old man. Wait for some time. I'll see to it that the box comes to the film archive." A couple of years later, after the death of the old man, The box was deposited at the archive. Unfortunately, by that time, most of the reels had been damaged and we could salvage only a couple of films, Muralivala and Sati Savitri, both produced in 1927 by the Maharashtra Film Company, directed by Babu Rao Painter. Then there is another chapter which I consider very significant, which is called The Neglected Projectionist. And this illustrates Nair Saab's attitude to cinema and explains his lifelong obsession, passion, unending romance with the medium. Going to the cinema is entertainment for many, but for me it was different. Of course, the entertainment element was there to a limited extent, but it was just incidental. After the initial thrill of the flickering images and accompanying sounds, I settled down to something serious. It may seem rather strange, but cinema going to me was more of an obsession, like going to the temple. And watching films on the big screen in a darkened hall was a spiritual experience. It hardly mattered whether the film was a mythological, historical, social, comedy, or thriller. Being a dedicated archivist, I hold the view that every film, good, bad, or indifferent, even Vinod Chopra's films, has its place in cinema history. As for value judgments, I would rather leave them to posterity. Puritans and critics of cinema may not appreciate my stand. Associating cinema halls with places of worship may sound outrageous to some, but I feel differently. This may be why I took the decision to ask viewers entering the National Film Archive in Pune to leave their shoes and chappals outside. Naturally, one expects the same kind of reverence from one's fellow viewers. Pioneer showman J.F. Madan set the ball rolling by setting up the first chain of movie theaters in this country. By the mid-1920s, his company, Madan Theatres, owned about 170 cinemas all over the country and accounted for nearly half the national box office collections. He named his cinemas movie palaces. Palaces are normally the abodes of royalty, the exclusive domain of the privileged few, the lucky ones. But movie palaces are meant for the common man to take time off from the drudgeries of daily life and escape into a world of fantasy, glamour, and make-believe. Naturally, the menu on the screen has to be in tune with the atmosphere where it is served. So what is being shown and where it is shown complement each other. This historical tradition is a strong point in show business. The illuminated hoardings and banners in front of the theater, the huge entrance, the rows of marble steps, the sliding glass doors, the red carpeted winding staircases leading to the spacious and chandeliered foyer, the air-conditioned auditorium with rows of pushback cushioned seats, every seat a cool retreat, as the management would proudly claim. The decorative murals on the acoustically treated walls, the outsized wall-to-wall CinemaScope screen protected by an eye-catching velvet curtain, and last but not least, the spotlessly clean and scented toilets. He obviously didn't visit Gaiety and Galaxy. These are the hallmarks of the traditional movie palace. However, barring a few exceptions, a majority of these theaters pay scant attention to the most vital aspect, namely the quality of projection in terms of image and sound reproduction, and the size of the projected image vis-a-vis the auditorium. This, of course, is now outdated, but it's important to read what he wrote at that time, because I myself have experienced this, watching movies in theaters which were shot in widescreen and projected in the normal format, and at times you could actually see the microphone dangling on top. I even saw the tracks in one film, and of course the lights were visible in many. Since the introduction of CinemaScope, every film is projected in widescreen format, irrespective of the original aspect ratio of the picture, with the result that the audience only sees half the frame, with the top and bottom mercilessly slashed, distorting the original composition the cameraman and director have so painstakingly tried to create. And if you have watched a subtitled print at a film festival or a film society screening, you must have noticed the heads of characters being chopped just to enable you to read the subtitles. Even though the lab's punch marks are there at the reel ends for the changeover cue, Projectionists like to put their own scratch marks. And if every projectionist puts his insignia, you can well imagine what happens to the images after multiple screenings. It is a pity that when crores are being spent in the making and showing of films in fabulous cinema halls, we don't pay enough attention to these basic points for ensuring quality projection and safeguarding expensive prints. The operator in the projection room who can make or mar a film during projection is one of the most neglected and poorly paid technicians we have in this so-called industry. Most of them have been trained on the job with no academic background. Theirs is a hazardous job, spending long hours in the heat of the projection cabin, exposing themselves to the fumes emanating from the arc lamp. All those who have anything to do with film should realize the importance of the projectionist and the need to have skilled and properly trained people for the job. I've often wondered why nobody ever thought of recognizing excellence in the field and encouraging new talent by instituting an award for the best projectionist. Just as we recognize the contribution of a cameraman, lab technician, makeup artist, actor, or costume designer, the same argument would hold good for recognizing the contribution of the best run cinema house in the country or state in terms of projection quality, upkeep and maintenance of the auditorium, programming and public service. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Vinod, it's your turn to say a few words.
The reason I couldn't, I had to ask Naseer to speak first because I was dying to hear what he had to say about Mr. Nair, and it was absolutely an amazing experience. Naseer, thank you so much. I just have to mention two things here. One, of course, Mr. Nair, and Mr. Nair ke liye Hindi mein kaha gaya hai ke wo suraj ko diya dikhane wali baat hai. Unko kya, unki kya tarif kare hum. Jis insaan ne absolutely, selflessly kaam kiya, aur what Shiva just said, let me tell you exactly what happened. I went to Pune and I saw him and his family was there. And I told Shiva, I said, you know, bring him here, put him in Leelavati, get him the best hospital in the world, and I'll take care. And what he said to Shiva is what Shiva said, tell him to, preserve movies instead of me. Which man can talk like that but Mr. Nair? So, claps for him, please. He was also, of course, he was preserving movies, as Mr. Benegal said, as Shiva said, but to me also, he was creating filmmakers. If I'm here, I'm here because of P.K. Nair. I think he taught us cinema in his own way. He was always there with his little torch, as Naseer was mentioning, and writing his little notes. And he was a very quiet, serious man. And if I wanted to study a film, there was a film called Breathless by Jean-Luc Godard I saw when I was very young, and I wanted to see the film again. So I made a request, and he said no. And he walked away, and it was a night screening in main theater, and he just told the projectionist, keep the print here for the night, okay? And he walked away. Dalvi, keep the print, and Kokji, I remember. And after he'd gone, Dalvi walked up to me and said, Nair Sahib said, he can't officially give you the print, but just sneak, take it tonight, study it, and give it back to me in the morning. That's Mr. Nair for you. I mean, to me, absolutely. So, and I still remember, Naseer Usme, there's a shot, long shot, hai, wo enter karta Belmondo, and then you go up in the room. So I wondered, ki, yaar, aisa kyon, kaise shot ho gaya? And then I realized that there was actually a slight tilt in the long shot, and there was a cut, camera was still tilting to the close-up. And if you remember in Khamosh, we tried that. He hated it, he was in the pool, tilting up, and he kept saying his directors dance. But I danced to the tune of Mr. Nair, because he's the one who taught me all those great movies and how to see films. And the second thing I want to talk for long is the condition of archival things in this country. Let me say something that will tell you how terrible the whole situation of archiving is. While Mr. Devanand was alive, I really wanted to have, I had sponsored some books on Guru Dutt, and I wanted to sponsor books on Guide, and you know, all, and I wanted him to talk and how he made the films. And so he said, par isme paise kitne hai? Maine kaha, sir, koi aapko nahi dena hai, hum preserve karenge aur aap hi ka copyright, there's nothing. Par Vinod, what are you getting? Maine kaha, sir, mere ko kuch nahi mil raha hai, main naam bhi nahi apna lagaunga, ye aap hi ka hai. He was not convinced. So actually, that opportunity that we had of people sitting and talking to him and how he made Guide, which so, and you know, was lost because he couldn't believe that I was doing it just because I wanted to preserve whatever he had in his mind when he made those films. And this is my appeal to everybody, and if film industry or anybody is listening, that they should help people like Shiva, because they are selflessly trying to preserve films, which is what Mr. Nair did. So there is nothing in archive. So we should all, I mean, Naseer and me made a great film. I talk of my films as great films, but not so great, perhaps. It was a film called Satya Katha, which was my first film with Naseer and Om Puri. And it was a film about Naseer was playing a cop in Bombay. And the film was all about this cop had his duty to, if there's a dead body on the streets, it was his duty to take it to the morgue. But if the body's alive, or if the person is alive, he couldn't do anything. So it was a film about a conflict of a policeman, which he played brilliantly. The film was not that great, but he was great. So he played that role, and he, you know, every time he used to take a little round and come back if the person has died. And it was one of, I think, one of my better films. And it's lost. It's not there. And I tried to look for it almost 10 years back, Mr. Benegal, not now. People went to DD, they couldn't find the negative, and it was shot on reversal 16mm negative. So it's all gone. And Om Puri was brilliant in that. That was also his first film with me. So it's very sad that this happens, and I would only request you, everybody, whoever is listening, to try and help, because this is how the future generations would learn. We learn from Mr. Nair, and it's very sad when I see all the students of cinema in this country only reading about how Martin Scorsese did that. Of course, I greatly respect him, how this director shot, how Francis Coppola shot, how this guy shot, how Roberto, and, you know, it's, but do they know how Guru Dutt made films? Do they know how Mehboob Khan made films? Do they know how K. Asif made films? And Bimal Roy made films? And Raj Kapoor made films? Not really. And it's very, very sad that our students are learning cinema, which is not really our, coming from our roots. They're talking, they're listening to, you know, all Western books on scriptwriting. They're talking about third act. I see these young writers working with, oh, so what is there in third act? I said, in Hindi cinema, there is no third act. There's music, you know, but they don't know, and it's very sad. I think I want to end, I talk too much, that archival things, everybody should please help. And if the government is listening, we can honor Mr. Nair as much as we can, but I think the government of India needs to wake up and give Mr. Nair some Padma Bhushan, Vibhushan, because he was the only one in this country who gave his life for cinema and taught all of us to be here. Thank you very much.
Can I now request Nair Sahib Bina and Nair Sahib's daughter and son to be here for the book release, and Rajesh Devraj, our editor of the book, can he come up on stage?
Yes. a part of this event today. And
बहुत बहुत बधाई देना चाहती हूँ शिवेंद्र जी को कि हमारे इंडियन फिल्म इंडस्ट्री के हेरिटेज को प्रिजर्व किया है और आज इतनी सुंदर किताब के माध्यम से हमें वो सब बातें देखने को पढ़ने को मिल रही हैं. सो आई एम प्रिविलेज्ड एंड ऑनर्ड. थैंक यू.
Well, I think Mr. Nair's work in the field of film preservation is invaluable. I think all Indians owe him a great debt for the kind of work he's done. And like Naseer Saab said on stage today, I think the government of India, I hope that they recognize his work and, you know, confer a Padma Vibhushan or a Padma Shri on him. Because this is the kind of work I think every Indian should be grateful for.
I think what we are seeing today here, the emergence of Film Heritage Foundation, it has its roots in the work that Nair Saab did in the Film Institute. This is the finest legacy he could have left, apart from the students who spoke about him and the way he inspired them and helped them. But this is something which can be the Film Heritage Foundation because it's concerned with the work that he himself did personally. So it demands that this organization rises very high to be a real memory of his work and a tribute to that work. And I'm sure it will, because Shivendra, the way he's bringing it up and all the support that he has got from the industry and everything, I mean, I feel very, very hopeful. My films are there with him in any case, so.
How does it feel? This is something you are never taught, that how do you feel? How do you think is taught, how do you feel is not taught, because it's subconscious, you know? And that you can make out from the way one walks, one dances, one sees, one smiles. And if you see that, what do you think? Have I enjoyed it or no? Right? That's what you know from the person's reactions, you know? Because this is something very unique. And anything which is done with passion looks always beautiful. It's something done without passion. It's korup. So this is a wonderful event in spite of the fact that Amitji couldn't come. Right? It didn't affect the dignity and the stature of the event. Because of the content. All those who are from Pune, you know, always wondered about this one-man army for film preservation. And actually that entire period, era, 40 years, 20 years, all Film Institute students will tell you that they learned great because of Nair, because he could show them what films were.
It was a lovely gathering to know about P.K. Nair, then all about the films, old films, and how they have been restored. And it was wonderful to hear Shyam and Naseer's talk, and also Chopra's. These things, the things that we don't know here, we come to know here about cinema. And thanks for inviting us.
Filmmakers of repute to give all what they have, and I'm sure Shivendra will follow in P.K. Nair's footsteps. But herein we must all come forward. Nair Saab followed his dreams. Shivendra must follow it commercially as well. He must grow and embrace a whole new generation of wannabe filmmakers and wannabe screenplay writers, technicians and actors. It should have a wide scope which can be recognized on a world platform. And when they talk about India, they should look around and say, oh, after P.K. Nair and the Pune archives, it's Shivendra Singh.
It's very nostalgic. I mean, you know, so much can be done. And I think it's a good start, I may say, because what Shivendra is doing is something I would love to have done also. I have a lot of, you know, some of the gifts which my father has left. I'm also wondering what is the best way, how to preserve them. So I think we all need to make a small community where, you know, we are passionate about what has been handed to us by, you know, as a legacy from our fathers or ancestral. It is not just necessarily film. It can be writing, it can be anything, it can be art. So I think it's a very lovely evening, beautiful evening. And I hope we not just end it with the evening, we should do some serious work about it. Projects, nothing has been archived. All these films are there in the archive, but they're not in the best of conditions, unfortunately. I'm still trying to preserve one particular film called Madhumati, which has not been preserved. And I'm hoping that, you know, something will happen and we can do, really look after the film.
It feels really wonderful. My grandfather, Jamshed Wadia, JBH Wadia, the filmmaker who made the very famous Hunter Wali films in the 30s, 40s, he actually was a great supporter of P.K. Nair's, and he's the one who in many ways encouraged Nair Saab to start the archives way back when. And in fact, I believe the first films to be deposited in the archives were my grandfather's films. So for us, it's really full circle to be here today to see this homage being paid to this amazing man. And as we heard at the ceremony, yes, it is wonderful to have this book and to have all these great people here today, but the film industry has a long way to go when it comes to really appreciating film history. The preservation of the past, the appreciation of the past, the lessons of the past that can be learned by the filmmakers of this current generation. I think we have a long way to go in that mentality. Let's move beyond lip service and make things a concrete reality so that the future knows what the past had and can actually learn from it. The Film Heritage Foundation has been a long time coming. It is something that should have been done years ago. I really applaud Shivendra and his team for having had the courage to strike out and actually do this, because it's not easy, it won't be easy, but step by step he is getting support from some very important people, and the more support he gets, the more we can actually disseminate what he is doing to a much wider audience, to get young people enthused, to get film students enthused. I think that will be the legacy that he will start from now. So hats off to you, Shivendra and team. I'm very proud that we have put our archives, the Wadia Movie Tone Archives, with the Film Heritage Foundation, and we really thank you for your support.
I would like to thank Shivendra for giving me an opportunity to be here. He's a wonderful person, and the kind of cinema heritage conservation that he is doing, very few people are so passionate. And anyone who, for me, anyone who is even remotely interested in preserving cinema heritage, I'm always there, because it's also my passion. So that's one reason, and second reason is that Mr. Nair has done so much on film conservation, and his legacy has to survive, and someone has to take this forward. So whether it is me, whether it is Shiven, so many other people are doing, but Film Heritage Foundation is taking a step forward, and all of us who think, who believe in their vision, should support them and come forward. And I am always there, because this is something very close to my heart. See, in India, cinema heritage is a very neglected concept. No, we have in the last 100 years, we have not seriously thought of giving any importance to preserving heritage or preserving films which are no longer available. But as of now, whatever is left, at least that can be restored. And that is something that Shivendra is doing, and I think it's a fantastic work that they are doing. And I support them, and there should be more organizations, and especially government organizations. Because individually, you can't do beyond a certain point. So if there is a government organization and the government support to organizations like Film Heritage Foundation and even Oceans, you know, so it will be a big boost to cinema heritage. No, I'm writing a book on the journey of Hindi cinema. That's NDK Books. And my book on Mr. Bachchan, that should be out in September. So these two books are there, then let's see.
I think it was amazing. What Shivendra has done is path-breaking, work in the field of restoration of films, the foundation of the Film Heritage Foundation, the establishment, by making the Indian nation aware of the importance of film archiving, of preserving old prints, of remembering what was made by the pioneers of Indian cinema many, many years ago, and the restoration work. Filmmaking is a vibrant medium, but what he is doing is making this vibrant medium something which will be remembered by generations to come. So I think after Nair Saab, he's picked up the mantle of restoration, preservation and archiving of films, and I wish him a lot of luck. I think what he's done is just amazing.
मेरे लिए तो बिल्कुल नया अनुभव था ये और बहुत ही अच्छा लगा मिस्टर पी के नायर का काम देख के. मैंने पहले नहीं जानता था लेकिन आज मैंने देखा ही हैज़ रियली वर्कड हार्ड फॉर फिल्म इंडस्ट्री एंड फॉर हिज सेफ्टी ऑफ फिल्म्स. हमें बहुत अच्छा लगता है. अब तो पुरानी चीज़ें रहेंगी तो अच्छी लगेंगी. आगे की भी रहनी चाहिए, पीछे की भी रहनी चाहिए.
Basically, you know, the most beautiful thing about today's evening was I saw a lot of resonance for what is there in the book with the event itself. Like, the book is an anthology of some of the most beautiful writings of P.K. Nair. Today's evening brought together so many beautiful minds of Indian cinema together. I saw some of the greatest actors, filmmakers come together. You had Shyam Babu, Shyam Benegal, that is, and you had Mohan Agashe, and you had people like Kalpana Lajmi, Aruna Raje. All these people are people who, Govind Nihalani, they are people whose work you have learned, grown up with. They are the, what do you say, the pillars of the parallel cinema movement. So they were all there, and if they have come together, you can imagine how special this book is. So I will ask all of you to go out there and get a copy and keep this book. Really, it's a treasure trove.
It's an honor to be at this event today. It's a very important event because the book, Yesterday's Films for Tomorrow, is in itself a very important book on films. And as a filmmaker, I feel that every filmmaker wants his film to be preserved. And P.K. Nair was somebody who preserved lots of old Hindi films, Indian films, and he actually preserved Indian cinema for tomorrow's generation. And I think Shivendra's contribution to of collecting his articles and his quotes and writing a book about that is great, huge. I wish him all the best, and I think that we all should support this kind of events and this kind of initiatives. I really wish all the best to Shivendra ji. I would love my films to be preserved. It is the first time that I've heard that somebody was there who used to preserve films, and it's very important because films are not preserved. Films are very important medium for like changing culture and to portraying culture. So I really feel that I will be honored if one of my films will be preserved, or all of my films will be preserved in future for future generations.
मैं तो ये कहता हूँ कि सरकार को ये चाहिए कि ऐसी फिल्म को अवार्ड्स दे, और जो आज भी हमारे फिल्म मेकर के और जो आर्टिस्ट हैं जिन लोगों के लिए ये बहुत एक अच्छी बात है, मैं तो कंग्रेचुलेशन कहता हूँ जिन्होंने इस फिल्म को आज सॉरी बुक को रिलीज़ किया है. और सरकार को चाहिए ऐसी चीज़ों के ऊपर ध्यान देना चाहिए. अगर जब तक ये ज़िंदा रहेंगे तो हमारी फिल्म मेकर जो आने वाली जनरेशन है, जो हमारी यूथ है, वो पढ़ेगी, उनको पता चलेगा फिल्म मेकिंग और सारी चीज़ों के बारे में. और आई एम रियली हैप्पी आज के इस इवेंट में कि भाई कोई तो है जो ऐसी चीज़ों को बचा के रखता है और जिन लोगों ने इतनी मेहनत से काम किया है, और हम लोग उनको बोलते जा रहे हैं ऐसा नहीं होना चाहिए. सरकार को ऐसी चीज़ के ऊपर ज़रूर ध्यान देना चाहिए, और उनको एक बार ऐसे जो राइटर हैं उनको अवार्ड ज़रूर देना चाहिए. पर
thank you everyone once again for joining us today. I would like to thank Anusha and Nandini for the wonderful PR you've done, the entire Dungarpur Films team and the Film Heritage Foundation for all their efforts in making this event a success. Copies of the books are available outside. Please do buy it, because that's the only way you can support us by one, by two, by three, and support us. Thank you very much. Thank you for everyone for coming. Thank you very much.